Welcome students, in today's class we will discuss the important articles from Economic and Political Weekly. Magazine is important from the it is not only important for the from the sociological point of view or for the optional subjects, but it is also very helpful in your GS1 paper as well as GS3. There are certain topics which comes in economics as well as society and as well as in essay papers. So today we will discussing the these three articles that are there in place. First one is reconfiguring the urban primary healthcare in the context of pandemic. Okay, then the pitfalls of skewed food policies, and the last one will be the Adivasi studies. So we will be starting with the first topic, that is reconfiguring the basically healthcare system. So we have to see basically the author has written the article in the context of COVID pandemic and how basically urban primary healthcare system basically collapsed. Okay, we witnessed the shortage of oxygen, medicines, okay, ICU beds, poor infrastructure. So first of all, what are the shortcomings that we witnessed in the basically pandemic area? Okay, so first of all was oxygen. These were the prominent things, medicine. Then there was problem with infra in the private as well as the public hospitals. Then basically ICU beds. Okay, so these were the major areas that were basically missing in the hospitals or in the problems that the hospitals were facing, and the problem was very severe in the urban areas. And along with all these, basically there was overcrowding, or you can also say that basically hospitals were overburdened with the number of patients that were coming in. So the author here has basically what tried to do is the author has tried to give the Mohalla clinics. You must have all have studied this or see have seen in the newspapers, Mohalla clinics in Delhi, that basically how they are helpful if they are properly utilized for the primary healthcare sectors, how they can free up the space in the secondary and tertiary sectors, how they can free up the basically space of the hospitals, and how they will be helpful to the public also, and how it can basically accept the proposal of the good governance also. So that are the basically is the main issue or the main focus of the basically what we say the topic that we are studying today, the urban primary healthcare system in the context of pandemic and the role of the basically Mohalla clinics. So the author basically what it tries with the article is that see the population in the specifically in the urban areas is increasing. Okay, it is 31%. Okay, according to the 2011 census, that 31% of the total population it is living in the urban areas. Okay, further if you will see that the number of towns, you will see that approximately they were about 5150. Okay, but in 2001, and they have increased to approximately 7200 in the according to the 2011 census. So we witness the stark increase in the urban areas as well as the increase in the urban population. So what is needed to be done? The need is that we should basically be well prepared before this situation like that has come across us, the pandemic, that in future also if the pandemic unfortunate circumstance like this happens, then we have to be well prepared for that. So first of all, to study the urban primary healthcare system, we will study basically what are the flaws that are basically in the urban primary healthcare system that has brought the situation of pandemic. Okay, or that even after take off the case of pandemic, what are the basic flaws in the urban primary healthcare system? To clarity, basically primary healthcare is the services in the hospitals that are given that are not emergency based. Okay, treating of basically diagnostics, okay, flu, fever, that the medical services basically that are not emergency based. Okay, that is basically primary health care. Okay, for your clarity. So first of all, what are the flaws the author states in the urban primary healthcare system? First of all, if we see real, you all will be accepting this fact that long waiting hours, especially in the public hospitals, if you will see, there will be a huge lines, okay, in front of the basically OPDs or in the basically where the what we say fees is deposited. Long waiting hours, basically the patients have to stand there for 2 to 3 hours to get their turn. That is a problem. What occurs next? If they have basically got their registration done, there will be unavailability of doctors. Doctors will not be there. If doctors are there, basically, then what will be there? Basically, unavailability of medicines. They will have to basically go to outside chemist shops to get their medicines. That we also consider, but say outpatient care, that is as high as 70%. You must be knowing that. Another flaw is basically overcrowding. Too much basically, because what see happens is, if there is a good hospital in the nearby areas, in the urban areas, okay, and in the peripheral areas or in the remote areas also, there is no proper hospital, no proper diagnostic centers. So the people, what happens is the people flock to the major hospitals that are specifically designed for secondary and tertiary care services, but to get their medical grievances addressed, the people flock to that hospitals, which basically results in overcrowding due to non-availability of good hospitals. Okay, then service delivery is low quality, very low quality. We have seen, or if you haven't, you must observe the fact that basically the attitude of the staff, that is their attitude of the doctors, okay, the helping hands that are there in place, okay, the basically sanitation that is there in place, okay, that is in abysmal basically state. Okay, so next problem with the hospitals is, or the urban primary healthcare system, is basically in our Indian society, the state of healthcare sector, what is happening is no efficient basically primary healthcare system is in place. We also discussed this fact in overcrowding of the basically hospitals. What is happening is, because to treat the normal medical grievances or medical problems, no primary health care is there in place. So what happens is, the hospitals have become the first point of contact even for the medical normal medical problems, primary medical problems, that also results in overcrowding. And what happens with this is, basically it results in overcrowding, basically underutilization of human resources and wastage of resources as well, because the hospitals that were built to address specific grievances that are basically kicked away. Okay, and most important of all this is, that is patient perspective. Basically hospitals, what happens is, in hospitals everything should be based upon the patient's perspective, okay, from the patient's view, that what the patients are feeling, what is the feedback of the patients. But what is happening is, the patient's perspective is totally missing in these hospitals. What happens, how you must have witnessed first, the harassment or the basically the poor governance that is there, because first you have to get done, you have to fill the forms, then you have to give the photocopies, then you have to get your registration done, then you have to roam around in different wards to get your to avail your services. Then even after, at the end, you do not get the availability of doctors or the medicines, what happens at that end is, basically it results in financial cost of time, because the individual who has done is specifically in the public hospitals, he must be from the lower middle class or from the lower class. He must have basically took a day from office, from his job or any labor activity that the individual is doing, and basically, and his grievance is also not addressed, and basically his day's payoff is also gone. So basically these are the major flaws that the author states that are there in the urban primary healthcare center. I will repeat once again: long waiting hours, okay, unavailability of doctors, unavailability of medicines, overcrowding of hospitals, basically patient perspective is filling, missing long filling forms, photocopies, registration, then basically roaming around in different wards, financial cost of time that is there, then service delivery is low in hospitals basically, and last one is basically because no efficient primary healthcare system is there in place. So the hospitals, the big hospitals that have become the primary contact of the basically for patients, backsiding the main tertiary and secondary activities that the basically hospital was meant to be built for, and it also results in wastage of resources and as well as the underutilization of human resources. So it is in this context basically that author advocates basically the model of Mohalla clinics, because Mohalla clinics, the according to the author, what is that basically they can efficiently fulfill the purpose of basically primary healthcare system and took off the burden from the big hospitals, as well as according to the studies that have taken in place and the success that the Mohalla clinics has basically seen, the patient perspective is their utmost priority. It is in this context that basically the author advises the model of the Mohalla clinics. So Mohalla clinics, what are the basic components of Mohalla clinics? First of all, they are only meant for primary services, primary healthcare services. What they do is basically, what is their basic idea that is there in, first of all, that is free consultation. Okay, anybody, if you have a minor problem that is not emergency based, you can go to the Mohalla clinics. There will be no fee charged from you, and basically you can get your grievances addressed. Next, totally paperless. Just give me a second. So they are basically totally paperless. Next, major, basically another major idea, that is this should be the first point of contact with the patients, that it is not needed that basically if the individual is facing some problems, medical problems, okay, that he should immediately rush to the hospital. If it is not the emergency, they should be addressed in the Mohalla clinic, so that the basically hospitalized hospitals can be managed efficiently. And basically last one is idea of family physician. Basically this is also very important, so we will discuss this. What is the basic idea behind this is, see, if you have a family physician, he must have a touch of empathy and a concern for you. That is the basically major idea behind the Mohalla clinics, that basically in the low income families or in the poor socioeconomic background areas, the individuals do not have family physicians, okay, or they do not adhere to the basically specific doctors because of the low income levels. So what the doctor, basically the Mohalla clinics have done is they have given the idea of family physicians, that if the Mohalla clinic is established in the particular area, so that individuals can flock to him and he can be of regular guidance to the individual in case of medical emergencies. So that is the basically major idea behind the setting up of the Mohalla clinics. So again, the components, what is the basic idea? First one, major, is first point of contact for the primary services. You do not have to go to the hospitals. First one. Second one, totally paperless, so that your harassment and all that things can be basically sided away. Individual does not have to wait. He does not have to basically pay for the financial cost of the time. Okay, that is the idea. Free consultation, so that proper diagnostics can take place. Okay, no fee will be charged, and the idea of the family position with a touch of empathy and concern. Okay, so this is the idea behind the basically setting up of the Mohalla clinics, and they are set up in the specifically socio-economic areas where the disease, what are the basically medical grievances that are coming out from specific area or the economic background of the area, though strategically they have been placed in the Delhi. Okay, and we all know that they have a national as well as an international recognition. So that author advises, basically writer advises the setting up of Mohalla clinic, and specifically mention the strengths that are there in place basically in case of the Mohalla clinics. So what are the strengths? Basically you can mostly derive the most of the strengths from these components only. First of all, ease of access. Accessibility is the most important thing that is there. Ease of access, because if it is easily available, easily accessible, some doctor is easily accessible, dispensary or the primary system is easily accessible, you will be willing to go to the that specifically medical center. You will be willing to avail the services. You will feel that basically I will not have to waste much of the time. Doctor also listens to me. He has an empathic touch or the concern. Okay, ease of access. Second, the major basically advantages, government has made sure that basically there is availability of doctors and medicines. So what happens in Mohalla clinics is the government has enrolled retired doctors or the doctors basically who were having small clinics. Okay, those who are willing to give their services, doctors have enrolled them, their pay is taken care of, and it is taken with utmost concern that basically that pay of doctors should be at a basic level. Okay, so that they are not underpaid. Okay, further, there is no delay in the payment, so that doctors are also willing to give their services, and the government has made sure that basically the medicines are properly in stock. So that is there. Further, we have already discussed that time spent in these clinics is basically very less. Okay, very less, because you just have to go and basically get your whatever your grievance is there, it will be addressed in no amount of time. That is there. Further, another major factor is the location, that is basically nearby. Okay, so what is this is also an basically very important, what we say, strength that is there, because if somebody individual is living in a far off area and he or she has basically some medical grievances, then he basically have to travel to a far off place. Okay, that sometimes take your willingness to travel, that I cannot, that basically it is very far off. Okay, and I further, if the individual does not have mode of transportation, that I will have to go to very far off place. So in that cases, basically if it is just nearby, you will be more willing to the access to the health services. Further, this has reduced the load on hospitals. We have already discussed, because they are the first point of contact in the services that are basically not emergency based, so that has taken the burden of the hospitals. Further, it is not very much, what we say, capital intensive, very small, what we say, capital requirements are there in the setting up of Mohalla clinics, because you just need a place, furniture, doctor, and some basic medicines that are there for the primary healthcare system. So they are also efficient in that case. So these are the basically strengths that are there for the Mohalla clinics, and the writer specifically states that they can be very much utilized for our vaccination process in the aftermath of pandemic, because now what is there is you have to rush to the major hospitals to get your vaccination services done. Okay, sometimes there is a vaccination hesitancy also. Okay, so in that case, these type of clinics basically they can be of major advantage. First of all, because they are nearby, doctor has a empathetic concern or the basic with the families, they have a connect with the families, they can promote the vaccination also, okay. Further, due to their widespread reach, they can reach far off areas, okay, because it will be like reaching to the doorsteps of the individuals to get the vaccination done. Now individuals have to flock to the hospitals, because if it is nearby, it is just reaching the doorstep. Okay, so this is the basically major benefit or the strength behind the Mohalla clinics. It is not to say that the author does not state that they do not have challenges with respect to this. The author specifically states the challenges behind the setting up of Mohalla clinics or the further running up of Mohalla clinics. First of all, we all know that to run something, you need a finance. Okay, finances are most important. Second, the bureaucrat who has taken this step, he might have himself or herself very much invested in this process. When he is replaced, the attitude of the another bureaucrat who is replacing the individual, it also depends basically how himself or herself basically they are investing in themselves in this process. That is the problem. Political will is another problem. Basically, are the political leaders also willing to adopt? Because sometimes what happens is when there is a change of government, beneficial schemes or the processes that are started by the previous government, they are shelved off. So these are basically, there are also the challenges behind this step. Okay, so further, to come to the conclusion part, so what should be the conclusion? Okay, so the author specifically, it can be helpful in your question that comes on healthcare, or if there is an essay on healthcare, these conclusions, these points can be helpful in that processes also. The author states that basically three streams, what they are? They are basically policies, problems, and basically politics. They need to, what we say, connect. Because if we will diagnose the problem, then only there will be an efficient policy making. Further, if there will be a political will, then there will be an efficient policy implementation. So these three things need to connect. This point can be helpful in your other answers also. First, another point that has the basically writer made is access to healthcare. Most important one is basically access to healthcare, where capital investment is not much. Okay, because sometimes what happens is our policy making, it only focuses on spending on big hospitals or setting up of big hospitals, and sometimes due to major capital investments, things do not take place. Okay, they do not get started. Initiatives like Mohalla clinics with very much less capital investment can provide access to the basically healthcare services, and can be very much beneficial in the case of pandemic or in the case of like vaccination drive we are seeing nowadays. Okay, further, other states basically can follow this model, but obviously we know that uniform approach is not required. Model is there, framework is there for the states. What the states need to do is they need to assess their ground situation. They cease to need their basically basic requirements that are there with respect to states, because they will be very much different from one state to another. So to take in these factors and basically modify this and adopt the model. Do not adopt as adopted by the Delhi, because the requirements in Delhi and the requirements in some other state like Jharkhand, Chhattisgarh, Punjab, Haryana, they may be different. So take in the local requirements, follow the model, and so that we can ensure the accessibility of healthcare services. And most important one is basically universal healthcare. Okay, universal healthcare basically, especially after the COVID, can be achieved only through models like this. This is a basically statement that the author or the writer has made. Because what is universal healthcare? Universal healthcare is basically access to some basic medical services, okay, to every citizen of the country. And these clinics can basically provide that, because they have the model we have already discussed. Free consultation, there is free consultation, totally paperless. and basic medicines they are keeping with themselves in the clinics. So access to universal healthcare can be taken, or it can go a further stage if we adopt on a pan India basis a model like this. Another, basically I will again like to clear that universal healthcare is basically access to some basic medical services free of cost to every citizen of the country, and they can be given in the mohalla clinics like this, which will be widely spread out with doctors and basically free consultation, paperless as the, and they acting as the first point of contact without going to going to the hospitals and overburdening them. Okay, so this is the basically the this article that was totally based upon. Again, in the short, basically the author told us about basically the problem, the or the flaws that are there in the urban primary healthcare system, the case of mohalla clinics, the idea, basic idea behind them, and what are their strengths, the challenges are also are there, and the conclusion that is there. Okay, this is our basically first article that was there in place, that was basically reconfiguring the urban primary healthcare. So moving on to next part, now we will move to second article, that is basically pitfalls of skewed food policies. Pitfalls of skewed food policies. See, what is there is the government, because we all know that basically according to the Tendulkar line also, we have 21.9% of the population that is basically below the poverty line. Okay, so what is happening is nowadays that the government has started many food specific programs so that accessibility to food grain or accessibility to some basic nutrition requirements can be availed by every citizen of the country. Okay, NFSA Act is there, midday meal scheme is there, so and so on, number of schemes are there that are in place. So the writer here basically makes a case against the basically the skewedness or the issues that are there in the in these food policies, or how they are hampering the economy also, we will discuss this. Okay, so first of all, the author starts with a statement by the that is Commission for Agriculture Cost and Prices, CACP. You must have heard from this. Basically, CACP has stated that government needs to liquidate its excess stocks. Excess food stocks. Why? They have given the reasons for this. They are twofold. First of all, they impact the storage capacity. Okay, because we have a limited storage capacity that is there with the food corporations. Another one is basically cost, because the cost that is required to maintain them. Okay, they have made a twofold statement here. Further, after giving this, the author states that basically how food grain production has increased over the period of time. See, grain production in 2021, it was 303 million in 2022-21. It has increased from 108 million. Okay, so from 100 million in 1970 to 71, from 100 million in 1970 to 71, it has increased to 303 million. That is almost the three times. Okay, so the basically the idea behind stating this is, the writer wants to state that there is an increase in the agriculture production. No doubt we have witnessed this immense production over the period of time due to stability in the agriculture, due to growth in the agriculture sector, our lessening dependence on the monsoons, our technological advancements that are there in the basically fertilizers, in the seeds, HVYV seeds are there, our irrigation practices have improved, our awareness regarding the agriculture practices have improved, weather forecasts are there, number of factors that are there that have contributed to basically to increase in the grain production over the period of time. But the main issue that is there in place is that government has to procure this increased grain production that is there, because what is happening is, you must have witnessed in the newspapers or in the basically news, that the share of crop production in the agriculture that is decreasing over the period of time, because other sectors such as livestock is there or fishing is there, their value addition to the agriculture sector is increasing. Okay, no doubt we are having the, you need to clear this, that no doubt our production is increasing, but the value addition in the agriculture sector of the crop production, it is decreasing over the period of time, because other sectors such as livestock or the basically fishing is there, aquaculture is there, the value addition from these sectors in the agriculture sector is increasing. So because what happens now is that if there is immense grain production is immense grain production is there in the country. Now if that will not be procured or that will not be purchased, basically that will basically affect the farmers, because the non-procurement will result in low income levels and they will be under the debt. So what is happening is, to offset this, government is going for grain basically procurement. Okay, with specifically number, writer has stated is that it was according to 93 million in 2020 that the government procured in the last year. Okay, so to offset the farmers' income, to basically to maintain a stable agriculture income in the farming, the government is going for the grain procurement. Government is procuring, that is fine. What the problem is, the problem lies ahead, is that the grain procurement is not matched by basically grain distribution. Okay, we are procuring, that is fine up to some extent, but we are not distributing it effectively. NFSA Act that is there in place, National Food Security Act, it states that 2/3 of our basically population is eligible for this benefits. Okay, that 2/3 of population are eligible beneficiaries under the NSFA Act to receive the grain distribution. So, but according to the surveys that have taken place, according to the reports that have been coming to the government, almost 100 million individuals have been excluded from this beneficiaries list. Why? They may be due to some number of factors. Exclusion and inclusion errors are there. We all know that basically somebody is included with some documents, forging of documents. Somebody is also excluded because the documents are not there. Okay, corruption is there due to include the name, to exclude the names, that is also there. Then the technological problems, the PSO machines, they require basically your fingerprints. Okay, but because the individuals who are in the labor activities, basically they have this erased off due to physical labors that they are doing, so sometimes they are also excluded. There is a inefficiency on the part of the government also. These are the number of factors that basically exclude the beneficiaries or the eligible beneficiaries from this process. Okay, so the author states that basically what happens is, the excess of this grain procurement and its inefficient distribution results in another problem, that is, just give me a second, that if there is an excess grain stock, what happens is basically normally that depress market prices. We all know that, because more the production, lesser the price, less the production, more the price, and basically it results in decrease of farmer income.
Okay. It is very easy. Excess grain stock depress the market prices, because if there will be more production, more quantity will be there in the marketplace, the prices will be low. If the, obviously it is a law of demand and supply, that if the supply is less, if the quantity production is less, the basically the price will be high. So low market prices and ultimately the low farmer income levels. So, and further, another impact is basically of this is, as stated by the writer, is that basically it also results in increase in the CPI, that is consumer inflation, which also reduces the profit margin of the farmers. The two major issues that are there in place, that are basically according from one from the government perspective, that is there the three issues that are specifically the writer is telling us. First of all, from the government perspective, that we are do not have the storage capacity, one. Second one that is there is that we have to incur us very much cost expenditure to maintain these food stocks. And from the basically farmer's perspective is that excess grain stock not only results in market depresses in market price, but also the reduction in the farmer's income, and it also results in increase in the consumer inflation, and which results in the decrease of the profit margin for the farmers. Okay, and further on the government's part, there is a governance issue that we have discussed, is that no doubt how much we are procuring, we are not able to basically effectively distribute that grain procurement, excluding the number of eligible beneficiaries that are there in place. Okay, further, the writer also talks about the supply side constraints. What are the supply side constraints? Supply side issues. See, because we are going for a monocropping, wheat and rice are our most major crops. So, commercial cropping is there in place. What is happening is we are not producing the nutrient crops. Okay, the crops that are that have high nutrition value, we are importing that basically food grains, and import of nutrient food grains. And what is happening with that is it is causing a burden on our exchequer. According to this article, the basically we almost import about 80,000 crores of pulses and oils every year. This is the cost that the government is basically incurring on the importing of the food grains, nutrient food grains. Further, what is happening is poor are not able to access these, because when they are imported, basically again the governance issues that we have discussed, number of them are excluded from the from this process. Further, due to import, their price is also high, and it is out of the reach of the basically poor individuals. The individuals with high income, they have basically accessibility to these the nutrient crops that are basically imported. And whatever is the government distributing, there is a governance issue with regarding to that things, with respect to the inclusion and exclusion errors, as we discussed with respect to NFSA Act, that there are almost 100 million beneficiaries, eligible beneficiaries, that are excluded from the process. So what is the way forward that the basically writer is telling us about is, it is that we need to boost the production, that if we are producing the excess ground basically grains, why not basically increase the production of nutrient crops, so that basically it reduces the burden on our exchequer. Okay, and the nutrient crops are available to all. Plus we need to manage our supply as well as distribution, because we need to consider how much we need to basically for our population, and how to effectively distribute that, so that basically our issues with respect to consumer inflation or with respect to depressing of market prices, that can be effectively managed. Again, in the summary, in briefly, the three issues that we talked about, basically first from the government's perspective, reduction in basically excess food stocks results constraints on the storage capacity. Second one is the issue with respect to the what we say cost that is required to maintain the basically that excess food grains. Because every year you must have witnessed, we see the news of number of food basically stocks getting destroyed due to rains because efficient management was not there. Okay, our basic torpedoes or the whatever requirement that material requirement is there to safeguard these food stocks, that is not there in place. That is the issue from the government's perspective, from the farmer's perspective, depressing in the market prices and increase in the consumer inflation. They basically both have an adverse effect on the farmer's income. Okay, and last of all, because we are going for the monocropping, only wheat and rice productions, commercial cropping, we are not producing the indigenous crops, we are not going for nutrient crops, we have to import these, incurring as much as high on 80,000 crores on pulses and oils. So, and these causes the issues on burden on our exchequer, and further it also causes the issue of accessibility to the poor individuals because of the governance issues that we discussed. So to tackle all these issues, we need two solutions that in the way forward. That is, first of all, we need to boost the production of our nutrient crops. Okay, so that basically our issues like our low ranking on the global hunger index, or our basically the problems of stunting, wasting, all that can be tackled, plus supply and distribution issues can be effectively managed. Because if supply is efficiently managed, the farmers will get a remunerative price, and if the distribution is efficient, then poor will also have access to these basically nutrient grains. So this was our second article that was there in place. Now we will move to third article, that is basically featuring the Adivasi studies. Featuring Adivasi studies, we will be talking of this article. It was way much more from the sociological perspective or from the optional requirements, but we will be discussing it according to the GS perspective that is there. So see, in respect of Adivasi or here tribal studies, we need to consider that basically since independence or even before that, in the pre-colonial times also, the debate on this issue, the issue of tribal identity, whether they are a homogeneous group, whether they are a heterogeneous group, or whether basically they are a part of the caste Hindu society, or whether they are not a part of caste Hindu society, that has always remained. Since the time these ethnographic studies have been taking place, somebody have taken the view in case of as a homogeneous group, somebody states that basically no, the tribals have a division within themselves also, they are different groups. Some studies have taken the place that no, they are distinct from the caste Hindu society, and so on. So, and you will also basically, we need to consider the fact that basically our constitution also does not define tribals. Okay, it only states that the basically the tribes that are included by the president. Okay, our constitution does not specifically define who are Adivasis or who are tribals. So this issue has been basically in the article has been discussed from the two perspectives. One is basically that is there in place, that is the colonial approach, and another one is a post-colonial approach. It is also called basically as an integrated approach also. Okay, post-colonial or integrationist approach. Okay, because this thing can basically come in your as the type of question that is being that are being asked in the society. In the GS1 paper, they are getting more and more technical in these areas, so that can be basically this area can be asked by the examiner regarding the basically views on tribal, whether it will not ask, they will not ask you the approach or the perspectives, but basically they will ask you basically the type of what we say, whether they are a part of caste Hindu society or whether they are not a part of caste Hindu society, like this. Anything can be asked basically out of the context, okay, to get it, to make it more technical. So first of all, we need to consider colonial approach. Colonial approach, obviously the British approach in the British period times. See, what happened at that time area is when the Britishers started to expand or the conquer the parts of India, forest and hill groups, they were the basically first one to vehemently oppose the British expansion in India. They reacted more violently to the British expansion than the individuals who were living in the mainstream geographical areas. So, the Britishers thought it basically appropriate that we should document these Indian communities, the various that the diversity that is there in the mainstream society, the diversity that we are facing in the hill groups, and specifically with respect to forest and hill groups who basically come attack us and again vanishes in the forests. So while documenting these studies, many diverse forest and hill groups were they were basically described in the one singular community that were called the basically tribe. They were described many heterogeneous communities, no doubt having different religious belief, having no contact with them, anything. Diverse groups, they were mapped in one singular what we say community called tribes. There were debates on the basically the tribal clan system, their religious beliefs, their political setup, their social practices, okay, and that debates, that discussions, basically they were not from the tribal's perspective. We need to consider this point, that they were not from their perspective, okay. They were made in these debates or these studies, the ethnographic studies that took place, they were made in comparison to the mainstream Indian society and to the British society. And because they had some sort of what we say biasness in them, because of the resistance that these groups were giving to the Britishers, they were described as uncivilized, dishonest, criminal, childlike, okay. And due to their indigenous beliefs and practices, basically they were described as primitive. We still have a word basically still in use, that is stigmatization of tribals, that is there with the word primitive, that they are primitive groups. Primitive means those who have not basically evolutionized, those who have not become modern and are still adhering to the old beliefs and practices that were appropriate thousands of years ago, but those do not have any place in today's world. Okay, so they were described as primitive, which also we need to consider this, which also resulted in their distinct, what we say, categorization as a distinct category from the Hindu society, because it was said that their religious activities are also different from the mainstream society, their setup is different, their social beliefs are different, okay, and they live in isolated areas, so they are distinct from the Hindu society, okay. And further, there was a biasness also, as I've told you, because the resistance these groups were showing, the Britishers wanted to isolate them so that they can be specifically targeted, okay. And further, what happened was that the colonial rule or the colonial approach, whilst documenting their studies, they blurred their approach basically of the long-standing history of the tribals, their self-rule that was there in place, their self-determination that was there in place, that was all blurred, and they were stated as, or they were categorized as, the primitive groups isolated from the mainstream society, those who need the basically what we say the guidance of the Britishers to get civilized. So these were the basically what we say the colonial approach that was there. Next one is to counter this was the post-colonial approach, or what we say as the integrationist approach. Basically this, the colonial approach, this has been criticized by the post-colonial thinkers or the progressive scholars who considered colonial approach as a construct to deny the self-rule that was very much present among the tribals, okay, to destroy it and to deny it, okay. So this approach that is there, basically post-colonial or the integrationist approach, as signifies from the word integrationist, basically it emphasizes upon the shared political, cultural and social history of the tribals with the caste Hindu society. okay, it was said that basically they are not distinct group, they are very much part of the Hindu society. Okay, you must have heard of sociologists like who made this approach that was there. Basically G.S. Gure is there, okay, then M.N. Srinivas was there, then Andre Bethe is there. These are the few individuals, you do not need to consider their name, this is just for your knowledge purposes, basically who gave this approach or who made significant steps to for this approach, based their studies upon this approach. So what did Gure state is, Gure stated that basically tribals are nothing but they are backward Hindus, okay, who could not be, because of living in the isolated areas, who could not be modernized, who could not be developed, and they have remained backwards. Because why they are backward Hindus or how they are part of Hindu society? Because they were born on Indian soil, they have worshipped Indian gods, and they spoke the same regional language that is present within the regional areas. He made number of studies to prove his point. So first of all is G.S. Gure, who states that tribals are nothing but they are backward Hindus, they are born on Indian soil, they worship Hindu gods, they spoke the same regional language. Okay, next one is Srinivas. You must be familiar with the concept of Sanskritization. Okay, what is Sanskritization is where low caste tribal groups or the low caste groups give up their practices and adopt the practices of the upper caste Hindus. Okay, and so that they can be more lifestyle aspects be more like the upper caste Hindus, in their how the type of clothes they wear, the type of religious practices they follow, okay, the type of food they eat, in every respect give up their practices and be more like the upper caste Hindus. So he states that in his studies that this Sanskritization specifically basically gives the evidence that basically tribals, because they want to be more like the upper caste Hindus, they are basically nothing but the part of the Hindu society. So that is the aspect. And then there is Andre Bethe, there is his famous study of that is class, caste and tribe that is there. He talks of coexistence between the Adivasis and the non-Adivasi groups. He tries to show that basically there is no difference between the both. These were the basically statements that were made by these thinkers. And further, this approach states that basically frontier areas, the where basically frontier is the isolated forest areas where these groups were living, they were not isolated from the larger economy in the pre-colonial India. Means before Britishers, they were very much part of the mainstream society, and the this frontier areas, they have an integrated economy. There was give and take between these areas. They were only isolated after the Britishers came, because colonial intervention, what happened was it destroyed the local economy. We all have studied this, basically how India was made into an importer of the finished good and the exporter of the raw materials, and constructed the these frontier areas as isolated areas to create the divide between tribe and caste, so that there cannot be an integration between these groups to for resistance. And because these forest groups are more vehemently resisting us, they can be isolated and specifically targeted, okay, and their resistance can be shelled off. So this is a critique that they are basing here is. So they also further, they also, these post colonial think basically approach or the thinkers, they also criticize the general assumption that is there in place, that is that the tribes have always lived in the forest areas and they have practiced the shifting cultivation. Okay, so this is the what is the post colonial approach. Again, in the brief, colonial approach is basically what to for their biasness, and in the comparison to the other societies, described the tribes as a primitive groups which resulted in their stigmatization because they were considered as backward, who do not have sense or who are not civilized, they are dishonest, they are criminal and they are childlike, okay, and who need the guidance of the Britishers to become civilized. Okay, that was the colonial approach, and basically they consider as because of their separate beliefs and practices they are as an isolated groups who are not the part of the mainstream society. So distinction between the tribe and the caste. And in the post-colonial approach, basically these thinkers, Gure, Bete, Sanskritization, with Srinivas through his Sanskritization, criticized this approach and stated that no, tribes are very much part of the basically Hindu society. There is no dichotomy as such. Isolation was created by the Britishers only when the local economy was destroyed and they were specifically targeted. And the general assumption that is there that that these individuals have always lived in the forest areas, that is also wrong. It is not to say that now this post-colonial approach also does not have its critique. It also has its critique. You must have heard of Zaza Committee that is there with respect to tribals. It states that basically this approach is also somewhere wrong because it does not consider the indigenous feature of the tribes. Okay, the separate religious beliefs and practice, the presence of matriarchal societies or the separate belief system or the worshipping of some indigenous gods or the presence of totems in nowadays in tribal societies also, it is also a evidence that basically the tribals are a distinct category. Further, he states that this approach also fails to consider the fact that there always has been some kind of resistance or some kind of what we say a fight between the mainstream society and the those individuals that are living in the forest groups. Okay, so why that resistance and why the separate belief, social system, political setup that is there, it also presents a basically evidence of their indigenous. So that are the basically two approaches that are there with respect to the tribal societies that are there. You must know that for your what we say GS perspective also, they are also being covered in your society part. You must have studied the integrationist what we say assimilation approach that is there. National park is integrationist and assimilation approach. That are basically the part of this only. Okay, so that will be all for today. We will also be providing the PDF of this, the notes that are there in place. Okay, so you can download them. So that will be all for today and we will meet next class. Thank you.